Okay, so we don't discuss a little bit about what we've just seen. So I run an organization called Blockchain for Good back in London, and I engage a lot with charities and NGOs and also blockchain startups, which I've been doing for 5 years. But I find both worlds are very disconnected. Blockchain startups, working in the NGO charity space, don't understand the role of charities and NGOs. I think they bring it down to it just being a fundraising tool. And then on the other hand, NGOs and charities still don't really understand blockchain. So what advice would you give these two people, these groups of people? What are the fundamentals, the truth actually right now? What can actually blockchain really do today, not in 10 years, for example?
I think that that's a great point, that we've really seen that disconnect. And I think that there's a big movement that will now come from this activist investor community. And I think that it's important to recognize our privilege being here today, being able to be and participate in these types of conferences. We've all had a really powerful insight into the power of this technology and in the economic growth. And I think that now we can see this new wave of crypto philanthropy start to come out, but really in the way that we can have more of a say in how of our money and energy is going to really solving these issues that a lot of these NGOs, a lot of governments are really working on. But I think also in the way that we can support our private enterprises in really partnering with NGOs and governments as well. I think that the power of the private sector is paramount in that.
Yeah, and I think it's important. So I've seen the same thing. We talk to a lot of charities, and they're not blockchain savvy, or they weren't until recently. You'd be surprised how many charities now are really catching up and seeing the potential. But I think it still always fundamentally goes down to solving the problem. And what is the problem that charities have is that it's very difficult for them to feedback on the impact that they're making. So if you have scandals like the Red Cross in Haiti happening, well, then it just takes one to tar the entire sector with the same brush. And so what we're trying to explain to them is that actually you can just feedback automatically, immediately to your donors and show exactly what impact you're making. And then it's a question of internally how you manage the different teams, because the operational people are just like, hell yeah, just give us the money, we're delivering every single day and we want people to know about this. The fundraising team sometimes a little bit more reticent because they have this model where they just need to hit their targets. They have people that are giving every month that don't necessarily ask for too much information about what they're doing, and they don't necessarily want to cannibalize them. But I think that's almost necessarily going to change as people adopt these new transparent ways of giving.
You know that show Portlandia where they say put a bird on it? I sometimes worry that people are just say like put a blockchain on it and everyone's going to jump up and start screaming. I think the most important thing to remember and know is that the experts in non-fiat alternative currency in the world right now are not the people in this conference. It's the billions of people that don't actually use fiat very often in their life, who are very poor. So in Kenya, there, for the last 10 years, we've had, there's been M-Pesa and Complete Mobile Money. It's still on a banking system, but most people actually pay each other often in phone credit because it's what people spend 40% of their money on if you're living on under $2 to $3 a day and happen to have a connection, which about 70% of people do in Kenya now. So the point being is that's really easy to send. Hey, let me send you a couple top-up minutes. That is a concept that we all should be learning from, and being inspired by.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch the original question.
I think it's my accent. I'm talking about from especially my personal experience working with charities and NGOs and the blockchain startups, two very different worlds that want to work together but don't understand what each other do. And in fact, NGOs and charities, for example, work with the underdeveloped countries, the other half of the world that's been untapped. They have different social rules, different political rules, different geographical challenges, for example. So you're playing around with a completely different medium and audience than if we were to just do a community B2B blockchain infrastructure such as EOS, for example, that's different, a challenge than actually working in the for good development space. You've got a whole new set of challenges the blockchain world doesn't know about. So it was like, is there any other tips and things that both worlds need to be aware of each other? But I do have another question for you, if that's not the right one for you. Did you not understand me, Steph?
Maybe I can jump in on it.
Horrible hearing loss.
Okay, I'll ask you another question, though. Okay. Revenge. if you've got anything to add to that point.
I think from what I've seen in a lot of the blockchain companies working in the NGO space is they don't understand the sector and they don't understand the problem. So there was one company that came out that was planning on banking the unbanked in Africa, and I asked them on their Slack channel, I said, how are these unbanked African women going to get money into your system? And they said, they'll use Bitcoin. This was a couple of years ago. I'm like, well, where are they going to get Bitcoin from? You know, there's two ATMs on the continent, and it's even hard at that stage to do it through local Bitcoins. And they said, they can send a bank wire for $50,000. I said, your unbanked African woman is going to send a bank wire for $50,000. And then you look at their team, and of course, it's 10 white guys from Russia. And it's not to take away from their initiative or anything, but if you don't understand the sector that you're working in and how difficult it is, it's almost impossible to have a successful business that's actually going to scale and make a difference on these populations.
Mm. And if I can just add to that point, we have been very good for the last 100 and something years in this philanthropic model that we've built of taking the principles of colonialism and applying them to how we change the world. And what this technology actually allows us to do, and where the companies that are in this space can take leadership, is by creating spaces for the people on the front line of these problems to express their voices and say, this is how we would solve the problem. That it's not somebody sitting in Geneva who's going to dictate how the problem gets solved, but it's the people on the front lines of the problem whose voices can actually be heard. That is a conjunction point where both of these two areas can come together. It's about asking the right questions and listening to what the people on the front lines have to say, to your point, so that they're not being asked to go and do a 50 grand wire transfer, but at the same time, they are not being ignored so that we build schools over here that they don't need.
Yeah. Exactly. And on the other side, in blockchain, we have a new rising community of crypto investors. And we've seen that billions have been poured into startups, so retail investors, individuals, willing to put billions into ideas based just on a white paper. And then we've got these other big world problems ideas that we'd love to fundraise for and get a lot of that money, but we're not somehow able to motivate them in the same way. I don't know, do we need to write a white paper or something? Like, what can we do? And I think as Ari, yourself being a social impact investor, as on a VC, how can you get people to motivate? How can we motivate crypto community investors to consider more deeply the investments they make, that they really have a positive impact on our society?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think we are all investors just by the very nature of spending money. So whether it's fiat or crypto, we are all making a decision and a vote with our money. So I think that's really important, that in all of our financial decisions, being able to focus on the social impact. But now with these new ICOs, with these new asset classes, you have so many different choices. And I think really looking into the diversity, the focusing on solving a problem, and really being able to have these new innovative approaches to solving these global challenges, we're going to see a whole new influx of wealth, and it will be distributed in all different types of ways, from geography to diversity of people. So I think that's also really important, that we see these new team members. And what Moeda is really focusing on is in gender equality. And we see that's not only the right thing to do, but the smart thing to do, that companies with women founders and board members are more successful. So I think that we need to, as a blockchain community, also really focus on that.
Mm, absolutely.
Yeah. And I mean, it's almost too easy to raise money at the moment. And there are a lot of ICOs that I think are really well-meaning, but as Anne was saying, that really don't understand the problems. And I think a lot of investors who are putting back their crypto profits into these projects are actually going to end up a little bit heartbroken. So, but I think it's like everything else. You need to do your own research. You need to delve in, look at whether the tokens actually make sense. There, you can't tokenize everything, and there are some token solutions that just make absolutely no sense whatsoever. Which is fine when it's a pure for-profit project, but when it's a project that's for good, I think it's doubly important to do your research, basically.
Yeah, I'm not an expert on crypto by any shape of the imagination. I've spent 20 years on the front line of social change. The reason I'm here today and part of this conversation is because what this potential represents for how we go about making the world a better place is something that I haven't seen in my lifetime, and I don't think has been around for 100 years. We have a massive opportunity to revolutionize the way that we make change in the world. And I would suggest to people who are out there who are making money in this space, or to people who are out there, I mean, I've seen a lot of blockchain stuff which feels like somebody's taken a business, stuck blockchain on it, and then tried to do an ICO. And I'm just looking at this from the outside. But it really strikes me that there are a couple of places where blockchain can make a massive, game-changing, world-changing difference, and this is one of them. And if you want to be involved in investing in something that you can tell your grandkids about that you were part of, this is the space that you need to be in. It's in these kind of arenas. And that would be my message to anybody who's out there who's sitting on a lot of this money.
The main thing I would say is I think it comes back to any sort of important principles. Like invest or donate to the team. I actually think that sometimes we get too caught up in the impact metrics and the navel-gazing of it. You know, I think focus on the problems, the SDGs. One of those problems isn't like corruption in the charity space. That's not a problem on the SDGs. That's not something that we should spend we should spend some time on it. But like from a size of problem, focus on the problems themselves. Get into that. I think you be ready for agile processes. Like expect things to change. Invest in a team that you believe has a good heart and is going to keep working to solve problems. That's all you can really do. Hmm. Don't get caught up too much in the minutia of metrics. Hmm. I think too much.
So my notion is that investors are very different. I've talked to lots of investors over the years, and a lot of them, in the Bay Area, have social good as something that they're after, and they really want to change the world. I suppose it's incumbent upon entrepreneurs to appeal to that because it does make a difference. They're human beings. Those considerations do enter the calculus for them when they're making decisions. But beyond that, you know, insofar as people are throwing their money at stuff that most economic activity is socially good. Okay, when you come down to it. But there's some that is definitely socially bad, and the people who fund that stuff are not going to go away.
I think what we need, though, really is at the end of the day a cultural shift where to define yourself as a billionaire should not be that you've made $1 billion. It should be that you've impacted the lives of 1 billion people.
That'd be great. on the topic of people always joke a little bit on the for good and what good means. What about? So I'm just bringing this one suddenly. Sorry, but what would blockchain for bad be? Sorry, is there any bad ideas out there?
Do you cause suffering to others? I mean, I think every important thing you learned in kindergarten. Did you hurt someone else? Are you causing suffering? Either currently to living or to any future beings.
Yeah, I think we really need to self-regulate this community as the other regulators are coming in, that we need to cut down on the fraud. We need to really be able to address all of the issues that the people that don't know about it, you know, it's just for drugs or money laundering, that we need to really show that this is a technology that is really going to be in our social and environmental benefit, and it will actually protect us against those issues that they're most concerned about, that we can have more transparency, accountability, and security. So I'm really, really passionate about getting good regulations on that.
Yeah, I mean, to some extent, and I know you agree with this, blockchain for good doesn't have to be applied strictly to the social sector. I mean, there are lots of companies out there that are trying to make property more transparent or more accessible or whatever, and that's for profit, and I think that's blockchain for good. I think in my view, in my position as a social entrepreneur working in the blockchain space, I do think that blockchain for bad is this land grab, just like this frothiness in the in these ICOs that are completely overhyped, that are basically grabbing all the money that they can and are eventually going to give the space a bad name. And I think it starves out the cash that can be given to really well thought out projects. And I would urge anybody who's trying to get into the social space to maybe check themselves and really look at the real problems, talk to charities, talk to people who are involved already.
I like to talk about the idea that we used to have a for-profit sector and we used to have a non-profit sector. I think today we have a for-change sector and we have an irrelevant sector. So the question, rather blockchain for good, blockchain for bad, for me is it blockchain for change, or is it blockchain that's irrelevant?
Well, there's different types of change there. I mean, change, changing into what does this changed world look like? I mean, you start going to dystopia, utopia. but anyway, I think we could talk about blockchain for bad quite a lot. Actually, I've got quite a few ideas myself, but we've run out of time. So thank you so much for joining us, and thank you so much to our panelists.